we as Kenyans, and especially the people who receive your media content from our couches and living rooms, we are so fond of seeing the problem of Kenya as something that needs to be sorted by people out there. Hezabika is really pointing the finger at ourselves, and particularly those of us who are believers, and saying, hey, if change is going to happen, if change is going to happen in this country, if change is going to happen where I am, it's going to start with me. And the reason why we don't, for many of us, why we are not starting up to be counted, sometimes it's because we want to do it, but we are not always sure how we can do so. And so this meeting is really about sharing between ourselves. And you've got some of people who are going to share briefly here, in a panel, we're going to ask questions and try to respond to them. The plan is hopefully each one of us will be able to say, hey, I'd like to stand up and be counted. And it looks as if it is possible to do so if Joe Agueo over these years has been able to do this and the other. Hey, in my circumstances, in my area of influence, God can use me as well. So that's what Hezabika is about. We're going to start with a short documentary, and it will tell you a little bit more than I have time for.
I want to welcome to the front space here, Monica and Kit and Cosma and Joe.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I took a public speaking course many years ago, and one of the things that the lecturer told us, when you have something to say, stand up, say it, shut up, sit down. And sometimes I sit in a church or sit in a forum, and I wish people would be given 7 minutes, make your point, you know? And if you can't say it in 7 minutes, you know, sit down. So it is a challenge, but it's also a good challenge, because it means that we can not waste a lot of time and really get to the point. The purpose of this forum, as has been already said, was to stir our minds. There is no way we can get into the depths of these issues. And I challenge you to create those forums where we can spend a weekend, even on just one of these, any one of these, and package it and deal with it. At a personal level, every time I stand up on issues like this, I find, as I begin to prepare myself, that I'm talking to myself. I discover my own inadequacies and my own, and I end up actually speaking to myself. So as I'm talking to you, I'm actually addressing myself and challenging myself on something that is really requiring all of us to be involved. In this whole spectrum of issues that we're going to talk about, I picked a rather broad, so maybe it's good that I'm starting out, because I'm taking a rather broad sweep at this whole issue. And my topic, you could call it the transformational power of media. And I want to begin by asking a rhetorical question, and that is, what is transformation? We all talk about transformation, and I think it is probably one of the most misused words. Every NGO, you ask them, what's your vision? How will you transform? Yeah. I think you would agree with me, just the fact that we were able to put in place a new constitution was significant. One could say that we have made some significant steps towards this transformation. But I think you will also agree with me, in many respects, if you look at what the nation is going through, the conversations, the issues that we're dealing with, you will quickly agree with me that putting in place the structures, the laws, putting in place these environmental things, which are very important, does not transform a society. There's something much deeper than that. And I think there were many people who thought, if we can just bring about this constitutional change, Kenya's going to go in a good way. And then you discovered that actually what we got was a new document. the character of the nation had not been changed. So we have a new framework which is important. In fact, if you go back, there were moments where we fought for multi-party elections. If we could just have a multi-party system of governance, we'd be okay. We crossed the line and you discovered the character had not changed. So the first level is the structural. And there are people, lawyers, and people in business, and people who are working at this level to try to align our society in a way that can actually be held accountable, can actually do what it says it wants to do. But the second level is what you can call behavior. Behavior is actually changing people's habits and ways of doing things. Like getting boda boda riders to begin to respect their lane will also help a nation to become a better place. You change behavior, you change habits, you change lifestyles, you bring improvements, much, much needed improvements to society. I would dare to say that we're still far, even if you're able to now bring good respect to traffic laws and people who are actually not bribing and this kind of thing, I would still say that we have still a long ways to go. The third level is the hearts and the minds of the people. I used a scripture earlier when I said that be transformed by the renewal of what? Of your minds. Because the same Bible also says, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. I would venture to say and to add, this is not in the scripture, but it seems logical, as a man continues to think in his heart, so he remains. As a man changes how he thinks, I want to believe I will change that man. Are you with me? If I can change, if I can get a hold of the hearts and the minds of the people, I will transform the society. And I know just like when I eat, the food I eat affects my body, what I feed in my mind affects my thinking, affects my priorities, affects my choices, affects my values. Once you got me here, you got me. And you can change me. I said that I was, in 7 minutes, just going to give you a broad brush. And I want us to focus on the feeding of a nation's mind. And what we are doing to either bring about transformation, positive transformation, or continuing to entrap a nation in a case or in a situation where transformation cannot take place, even if we try to change behavior and put in place structural changes. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Felix. I've never looked at it that way. So you're actually cooks, not journalists. Or are you farmers? All of the above. I want to challenge one of you to pick what Pete has said, and when we are done, we'll ask you to give us a 2 minutes response to what he said. And in the event you don't volunteer, I will not threaten, but I will promise to volunteer. Who would like to make a response? Rari, would you like?
I'm afraid I have to leave shortly.
Okay, who would like to respond to Pete, Laura? Not right now.
Oh.
When we're done.
Oh.
When we're done.
Okay.
So, in other words, I'm twinning in with Pete.
Okay.
Yeah. Excellent. Cosma, we actually haven't heard your voice, so I think it's best we come to you. And feel free to sit or to start, whichever. And if you see me do that, you have 2 minutes.
Yeah, I understand. Good morning, everyone, and I'm glad to be here. My name is Cosmo Magateri. I didn't have the opportunity to introduce myself before. I'm a follower of Jesus, a long-time focus associate.
Actually, we were at the All Saints Cathedral. I remember after my graduate studies overseas, I came back and I was actually chairing the Nairobi Associates branch, and we actually used to meet here in this facility and bring together several associates to talk over different issues. So it's good to be back here. And I'm happy to be with media people. I have a background in communications, strategy, marketing, as well as public policy. After my undergrad, I actually did the stint of the School of Journalism. I interned with Reuters, went overseas to do a MSc in communications, and also interned with Radio France International. My studies, I was doing that in the University of Paris in France. And had a long career in different media-related issues. So I did public relations consulting. I also went on for over about 10 years to work with the World Bank, most of that time in Washington, and doing many things, policy communications, risk management. But one of the things I did, I was actually being media relations manager in the corporate communications office. It used to advise the president, the vice presidents on their media relations and policy communications. So I used to deal a lot with journalists and media people, so I really do feel I'm talking amongst friends and with family when talking with media. I also happen to be passionate about issues of marketplace engagement and the fact that I really get pained by the fact that we have so many Christians and no much impact. And I think it's really because we have failed to understand what is God's design for society and his model for social change, or even to use the term Pete used of transformation. I think we have got a fundamentally wrong theological view of this. And I don't know where it came from, but we have, unfortunately, in our profession, separated our faith and the spiritual from what we call the secular and the marketplace. And we're all Christians here, so we can look at the Bible. Where do you see, going back to Genesis, God having two acts of creation? He says, okay guys, I'm now creating the secular, and I don't want you to touch it, move away. And I'm creating the spiritual and the sacred. Please be involved in the sacred. God created everything and declared it good. And at the end of 6 days, in fact, he said it was very good. No secular, no sacred. Everything was done to the glory of God. And I think we have unfortunately created this society of souls. Thinking that God created a society of souls, he created human beings. The souls are not floating in the sky somewhere. You know, we think that in fact our destiny is, you know, to be floating on clouds, playing violins and so on, you know, rather than to transform and to renew the world God created. If that's what you believe, well, better get started on those violin lessons. God created souls. He put them in bodies. He put bodies in community. He put community in structures of society. And he wanted us to engage. And I think that if we look at our daily work as a high and holy calling, as something God wants us to do, to renew and transform this broken world, including in your day jobs as the media, you'll approach it in a very different way. So, we need to see that what we're doing on a day-to-day basis is at the heart of, it's at the center of God's plan of renewing and repairing that which is broken in the world. It is not separate. And the way you do it, the way you serve God, is in your profession and not out of it. Let me just say one or two things to bring this into perspective. I think we sometimes lack a view of how we exactly go about doing this, bringing about change. And I'd like us to give you a model on how we Christians should engage in the marketplace. There was the video where, you know, the professor was talking about the triangle. So I'll also give you my triangle. And since there's no chart here, I'll kind of skyrocket. So imagine the triangle. And we've got three sides to it. The first thing that we should do as Christian professionals, I think, is first of all to autograph our work with excellence. I'd like to give you a reference. If you can write this down, please read it, write it, and then go and read this essay. This is an essay by a lady called Dorothy Sayers. Sayers is S-A-Y-E-R-S, Dorothy Sayers. And it's a PDF, you can download it. And the essay is titled, Why Work? Why Work? She's probably one of the very best Christian thinkers on the whole issue of integrating faith and work. Of course, it is easy now. She lived in the last century. But very influential writing, and her ideas today are as fresh as they were ever. And she says this, that we need to remember the author of all work is God. We're Christians here. Tell me, what are the first five words of the Bible? Let's say them together. In the beginning, God created. Creation is actually work. In the first five words of the Bible, God is revealing to himself to us as a working God. He is the author of all work, including the work in the media. So, excellence means you are honoring and working out of respect to the author of work, who is God, and everything God did, he did well. Work with excellence. Proverbs 22:29 is the verse I love. Have you seen a person who is skilled in their labor? Other translation says, have you seen a person who desires excellence? They shall serve before kings and not before ordinary men. Autograph your work with excellence. The second angle on that triangle has to do with ethics. Operate in an ethical framework. I close. So you've got your triangle, you've got excellence, you've got ethics, you've got engagement for reform. Since you're drawing, if you draw that, now here's what you can do. Draw a line from each of the corners, a line from the top, a line from the left, a line from the right. And in the middle, you have got another E. And that E is what I call evangelism. So evangelism, my friends, when you say I'm going to the office to evangelize, evangelism is not about going and having a morning devotion. Evangelism is about first and foremost being an excellent reporter. The most Christian thing you can do as a Christian journalist is be the most excellent journalist. That is your first and foremost Christian duty. You can operate with the best ethical framework. You can engage and seek to renew and reform the place. And that is what gives you the platform and the credibility for evangelism. Evangelism is not something we should separate the spiritual from my sacred job of doing the media. Evangelism is central to everything you're doing, including the quality of your newscasting, the quality of the way you're reporting, the quality of your editing, the quality of your engagement in that editorial meeting. All of that is evangelism. It is not separated. There's no brick wall between the two. I said I'll just finalize on this bottom line, which is engagement for reform. Engagement is really about three things. When you talk about transformation in society, when you talk about engagement, and when you talk about renewing your particular, you know, your particular professions, three things. One, think of the individuals. So, be relational, minister grace to other people, and remember you're dealing with human beings made and shaped in the image of God. So deal with them in respect, and deal with them as fellow human beings. So individuals, I think they're always people. You as individuals, when you go out to report, you can report the facts, but always, as you know, what is the human face? What is the face behind the story? So think about people, individuals. Secondly, think about institutions. One of the big problems we have about social reform and social change is that it is individually championed. It is never institutionalized. We've thought of examples, I think, in Kenya. I think to me, the best that comes to mind is the big reforms you had, driven by a big reformer in the matatu industries, where matatus were going unruly, but you had somebody, by sheer force of character, drove the reforms through, and they started towing the line. Unfortunately, those reforms were not institutionalized. And then what happened? When the individual left, there was some backsliding. So institutions matter. So if you guys can help make your institutions, your organizations, your companies, better places, and this means engage in these media councils. Engage in those meetings in terms of renewing the systems, the policies, the structures, the framework, the architecture, the design of the institution itself. So the institutional framework, what is called in using development speak, institutional capacity building, because institutions outlast the individuals. But here is the final I, and after this is my final comment, then I sit down. Individuals matter. Institutions are important. You can institutionalize this in order for it to last. But they all rest on a framework of ideas. Ideas are the thoughts that underlie the narrative that you guys are reporting need to be true. Jesus, standing before Pilate, said, "For this reason I was born. For this reason I came into the world." Dot, dot, dot. Do you know what he said next? To defeat Satan? No. To bear witness or to testify to the truth. The reason the Christian faith has a claim and its merit is because it lies on a foundation of truth. So if you guys are reporting, you can report to the greatest excellence. You may be very ethical. You may be engaging. Make sure what you are reporting has an underlying narrative of truth. Tell the truth. Yours is really about truth-telling, well-told. So I just pray that that narrative, the stories that you're saying at the bottom, would be truthful. So let me end with that. Thank you.
You agree with me that these are actually institutions by themselves. Laura, who's going to respond to Cosma? Are these consonants? These are vowels. In ways that you can remember. So Cosma, four E's. And three eyes. Alright? Because he's added at the reforming of the institutions, why don't we go straight to Monica? Monica has a free hand because she is what she is. You know how women are versatile. So I've given Monica a free hand to deal with reforming institutions because she's been at the Media Council and she's at Ipsos, but she's also a woman in business. So, you know. Women here can resonate with Monica. So as to give you, I'll give you an extra 1 minute.
Okay, thank you so much. Thank you so much, Sarah. It's really an honor to be here and I'm really grateful. Like she says, I come in the capacity of many hats, so I'll try and be as articulate and, you know, smooth flowing as the gentleman who's spoken before me. Now let me begin by saying it's really nice to see the constitution of the members we have in this room. Because I work at Ipsos, I like dealing with data and statistics, so I'll start my presentation by just giving us a few statistics. Now, we are all talking about the youth bulge, and we know that Africa has 90% of the world youth population, so we have about, 224 million youth in Africa. Now, let's come down to Kenya. The median age in Kenya is what? 19. That is the median age in Kenya, 19. Over 80% of Kenya's population is under the age of 35. Those are the statistics. And when I look around this room, say for the few of us, by the way, I'm over 40, looking at the few of us who are outside of that bracket and we are the minority, a majority of us are in that bracket. So what does that mean? You have the opportunity to transform society, to transform Kenya. You're in that group. You understand the population. Now, the title of my presentation was going to be Winning as a Minority, but you've actually just talked about the key things that I wanted to talk about, which is excellence, ethics, and integrity. So what I will do, because I don't want to repeat what has been said before me, is just give you a little bit of my experience as being a minority in the different fields that I have worked on a professional level. Now, I'll start with when I was in the media. I have a long media career, and my last media direct engagement was when I was at Hope FM. I used to manage Hope FM as a station, but I started as a presenter, became programs controller, and then ended up managing the station. You remember me that? Okay. By virtue of being in management, I actually used to sit at the MOA, the Media Owners Association meetings. And even as Sarah was introducing me, first you're female, you you're young, okay, those days, you know, it was, you know, a few years back, you're young, and then you represent, you know, the stations that to some people don't matter. You don't have much listenership and that kind of, and you're there to discuss strategy, to discuss direction, where is the media going? And one of the key things that stand out in my experience was the time when we were looking at the Media Act. At that time, it was a bill. And whether we had to even have a blackout, Joe, I don't know whether you were in the country at that time when we were discussing that. And as a Christian, I remember sitting to, and I'm not going to mention any names, sitting next to one of the big five, sometimes sad because we also go to Malawi. And you know the transport business, with the traffic police, and the corruption. Now, when you stand up and say, I want to be counted, my company is Workmanship Productions Limited. It's just up the road. In fact, we are hosted by the Association of Evangelicals in Africa. It's just up the road near the Chancery. And that is a very difficult business because I started the business in 2008. And yes, the challenges are there. Standing up to be counted, there's a cost sometimes. There is a cost. There is a sacrifice. But let me tell you, if you're going to stand and associate yourself with the name of Jesus Christ, you have to pay the price.
Right.
And that wouldn't mean to be counted. So for me, my challenge to us, you know, from an individual point of view, whatever it is that you're doing, shortcuts are there. And sometimes they are very, what can I say, tempting, you know, to go about. But if you truly are saying, I want to stand up and be counted, I want to bring transformation, I want to bring change and engagement, it really has to start from an individual point of view. You have to believe it, but you don't just have to believe it, you have to live it. And truthfully live it. And that way, as you take your next steps in everything that you're doing, how do you treat your house help at home? How do you talk to your siblings? How do you interact with your friends? The other day, someone was telling me at the office, because at the office, I am a Christian. And there are people who will not invite me to certain places because they know Monica will not be comfortable here. I will give you a personal example where we sit in an open plan. They actually don't listen to some media because they know I will get offended. But when I'm not there, oh, they will go about it. For us in this room, do people around us know that we are Christians? Not because we go out saying that we are, but because of how we live our lives. I'm not saying I'm perfect, no. But by God's grace, you strive every day to get to that point. So that as you stand up, you really have that moral authority. And people will respect that because that is how you live. So this individual came to me and told me, no, Monica, I don't know how to tell my friends that I'm a Christian. I don't know how to do it. Mm-hmm. And I looked at her and I was like, you know, yes, it can be difficult, especially being in this age group where you want to fit in and be part of it. We talked about a few strategies and she came to me the other day and said, you know what, I did and now I'm inviting them to church. So it has to start, and that's where I'm going to close. It really has to start with you as an individual. As you raise your hand up and say, Nimehesabika, it has to be with how you live your life, and because we also have a higher calling. Thank you.
Hello, how's everyone? I am still trying to understand why I am the last to speak. Two days ago, a friend of mine is a colleague we work with, called me and said, well, I have a problem. Then I said, what? And she said, it's a friend of mine whose child disappeared 2 days ago in a supermarket and hasn't been seen to date. And so I said, what would you like me to do about it? Because I thought she was just telling me a sad story. And she said, can you guys do a story about it? And because I haven't seen a story like that done on TV for a long time, I told her, let me see what can happen. I'll get back to you in a short while. And so it happened to be around 3 p.m. and many of you know that that's the time that there is a meeting that decides the agenda for the evening. And so when I went for the meeting, I asked, after we had done all the serious stories, you know, the tear gas, the crisis and all the different things that are very important. I asked at the end of the meeting, like, guys, there is an interesting call I got a few minutes ago. We had a group of editors in there, and I said, there is this lady who has lost her child in a supermarket, and it is now 2 days that child hasn't been found.
what do you guys think? Can we do a story? So I went, the first person said, no story. The second one said, no story. Mm. And by the time it got to the sixth or seventh person there, I said, wait a minute, why is it not a story? And then one of them said, you know, there are very many people losing their children every day, so why is that a story? Mm. And then the next one said, in fact, if we attempted to do this story tomorrow, there will be a queue at the gate of people whose children have gotten lost over the last few days who would want us to put them on TV. And then I remembered that just a day before that, there was this child in Japan who the parents, for some reason, thought the child had misbehaved, so they abandoned the child willfully in some forest somewhere as a form of punishment. And then when they went there 5 minutes later, they couldn't find the child, and for 2-3 days they were looking everywhere, they couldn't find their child, they had gone into a panic. But it was a big story, and you know, it was that we know about it because it was covered by CNN and Sky and BBC and everything else. And I remember that a few years ago I happened to live in one of the Western European countries and for about a year, and I noticed that every time a child disappeared, it was a very big story. And they had news helicopters and they would be live from a home and try to map the route where this child had followed to school, for example. So I asked these people, but this is a serious thing. I asked, is there anyone around here who has a child? And it happened that everybody in the room had a child. I said, if it was your child, would you be here today? And everybody said, well, you wouldn't see me here because I'll be looking for my child. And so, in the end, everybody there got this brilliant idea that actually we can do this story. And then unfortunately, and I say unfortunately for a good reason, a few hours later we got a report that the child had been found and therefore there was not going to be a story. So I'll come back to this child in a moment, but when Pete started speaking, I got a sense that he had seen my notes because he was just a few seats in front of me. And that is because whereas Sarah had asked me to speak about walking the talk, it's a very long title, and I tried to keep it in my head, so walking the talk, keep maintaining the faith in the media and all these dynamics. It was one of those things that can only come from someone who's worked at CMD. But what got into my mind when I was going through all of these things is that keeping the faith part of it, because this is very biblical. And we know about the story where Paul writing towards the end of his life in 1 Timothy 4:7, I think it is, where he's talking about fighting a good fight, running, finishing the race, and keeping the faith. Alright? So, that keeping the faith aspect rings to me in a different way, because Peter was talking about the power of the media in transforming society. And he talked about important things about how we as media can make things happen out there. But I am more interested in about us. Before we transform those people out there, and you've heard about the power, every day we're told the power of the media, the power of the pen. There is power everywhere when you talk about the media. And I choose to speak about one aspect, which is the fact that we are very powerful as media. And so what then is our attitude towards the power we have? Because that is what is going to make a difference, whether we use that power in the manner that we should, in the manner that transforms society. Okay? Because when it comes to things like brown envelopes and everything, here is how I choose to look at it, and I don't want to spend this very precious moment talking about it because where else?
Yes.
Hello?
Yes. That's true.
Because there are many, many big brown envelopes out there in some procurement officer's office, or those cops who take 50 bob or whatever it is. Mm. So at the end of the day, for me, this is not a journalistic question. Mm. It is at the heart of who I am as a person and the attitude that I carry towards the role and position that God has given me. And so the reason I go back to this attitude we have towards power, because it is going to move us to think about that child who got lost in a supermarket as an important issue in society. So at the end of the day, it is about your worldview. When you sit like this and look at the world, how do you see the world? Because when you talk about standing up to be counted, it's very easy. Right now, everybody can stand up to be counted. But to be counted doing what? Mm-hmm. Somebody here said that God is a doing God, that within the first few sentences of Genesis, there is a doing involved, right? And if you read the account that Jesus gives of all those these people who were given different talents, what happens in the end? Well, done. Good and faithful servant. Did it say well said or well anything else? It is well done. So there is a doing involved before we can be counted as good and faithful servant. When you look at all this translating concern into action, that is doing something, isn't it? So the reason why I talk about power is because power enables you to do things. And one of the things that excites me the most about the most profound lesson that I find in the Bible about the place and the attitude of power is in a story that Jesus had to deal with in Matthew 20:20. If you go through that scripture, you'll see it. But it is a story of this mother who goes to Jesus with two of his sons, and he says, I want these guys to be powerful in your government. I'm just trying to speak in our language here. All right? I want them to have positions of leadership. And Jesus goes into a whole conversation about what these guys are talking about. But in the end, towards the end of that story, there is a profound statement that he makes. And he says that the Gentiles, the Greeks, they lord it over people, they feel powerful, and they want everybody around them to know they are powerful. That is the paraphrase here. But he says, whoever wants to be great must first of all be what? A servant. Mm-hmm. All right? I'm coming home with this. I want you to understand where we are as journalists. That whoever wants to be great, he's giving them a formula that if your power, the leadership, the power that you seek here is going to make a difference, then here is the attitude that you must adopt. That is the attitude that will make you change society. Because it is the attitude that will give you compassion. When you look at everything that is happening in the country, it will make you feel something in your heart, that you're going to translate the power that you have to make a difference. And Jesus says, like, I'm not just asking you to do this. This is actually why I came also, to serve. So when we look at what we do as service, then the power that we have as the media begins to make sense. Okay? Because we are not just powerful because people know me, hi, John, hey, how are you? But we are powerful because we realize that there is a divine formula of using our power to make all the great changes that the people in Frontier have talked about. And God recognizes that. The first thing that God gave to man was power. Do you realize that? When you read Genesis 1:26-27 says, let us make man in our own image and let him do what? How? That is power, isn't it? The last thing Jesus promised when he was leaving, you shall have power after the Holy Ghost has come, and then you shall do certain things. So it's not just power so that you sit there. It is power to do something. And so when I think about my position and my role in the place where I work, I want to see this as using my power to make a difference, okay? So it is more of the attitude that I have myself, recognizing the unique place that God has placed us, and then translating that power in the formula that God himself has given us, and then making a difference in society. Let me now come back to the Sarah's very long statement about keeping the faith. When Paul talked about having kept the faith, he says the faith, okay? He's not talking about some, he says the faith. And there is something the Bible says about doubting, right? But we are trained to be skeptical about everything we hear and everything we see. That every time I see my brother here speaking, I'm supposed to imagine there is something they're hiding that they don't want me to see. All right? So the problem here seems to be that we are in this industry that is very different from Christianity. But I want to go back to where I started, that if we begin to think about ourselves as trying to meet the very goals set for all of us as believers before we think of ourselves as journalists, then we begin to find a formula on how to deal with this thing. I'm not going to stand here and say, here now is the chatter of how to succeed as a journalist in the media. Which is why I fell back on what I believe to be the golden formula of using the transformational power that each one of us has wherever God has placed us, so that we can effectively meet our objectives, so that we can effectively meet our calling as journalists, because that is what we are in. We are in a calling. So by the time we are done with this, are you able to sit there, stand there, and say, I fought that good fight, I finished that race, I have kept the faith? And I said that brown envelopes shouldn't be a big conversation, that by the time we're having a conversation about the brown envelopes, we need to have very many other conversations. But I really believe that from where we are right now, it is time for us as people who have this immense power to determine how people think about society, to rise up and play that role. And that role will not happen until we know what it means to be where we are, until we are looking at the power that God has given us with the same prism that God himself looks at the power that he places in our hands, which is to say that we are in this space to serve. And when we are in a space to serve, it means we are humble. It means that we look at the world and we see what Jesus would see. The Bible in 1,000 places says, anytime Jesus looked at the crowd, what did he feel? Compassion. That is what you feel when you begin to look at the power that you have with humility, because you want to use that power the same way that the one who gave you that power would want you to use it. I'll leave it there because I'm sure there will be a lot of conversations after this. Thank you.
Sounds like he said your responses are. So I'll start with Osborne, because I think that's really what is. And we won't ask you to respond immediately, Joe. It may be a question, it may be just a comment, an additional, and then we will open ourselves up to just dialogue together. And when we're done, I'll be asking the panelists to say their final word, just a wrap up, a quick wrap up, what we call in my language, otriha. I don't know what that is in proper English. Anyway, it's just wrapping up, I guess.
I would like to start by just reading a scripture, if it's allowed. Genesis 2:19. It says, I'm using Message Bible. It says, so God formed from the dirt of the ground all the animals of the field and all the birds of the air. he brought them to man to see what he named them. Whatever the man called each living creature, that was its name. The man named cattle, birds, there, the wild animals, but he didn't find us to find it. But I just wanted to touch on the creative end of the last part where they say God, man named animals and everything that God brought it. I think for me, from Joe, what Joe said, the issue here is identity. That's what I was able to capture from there. If you know who you are, it's not very hard for you to operate from where you are. And the biggest challenge in our media world is that we always do what everyone does. As he gave us the story of this boy who was this child, I don't know if it was a lady or whatever it was. Everyone said, this is not what normally is in the media as news. So the problem is, when you're in the media industry, you just do what everyone does, or you do what you feel maybe God is leading you to do. Because here, I see man as the creative finish. It's like God creates, and then he brings to man, name this, name that. And whatever the man said, when he said he's an elephant, God said an elephant it is. So for us in the media world, I think if you know who you are, who God has made you to be, as in you're supposed to be very creative. And creativity is not about the imaginations, the things that you think, or going back to what has been, as always people say, how does the history, they look at the history and then they determine what's supposed to be done based on the history. But for us, we are filled with the Holy Spirit and we are the creative. And it means God has allowed us to do what? To finish whatever has begun. Now, in the media industry, it means God is supposed to be dropping ideas in our minds on how we are supposed to do things. And we do different. But the reality is, we always do what everyone does. Now, if you are, you know God has defined you to be, you cannot be even defined by your boss. And when you are and wherever you are, you are very confident because you know you tap directly from God. Mm. So I think for me, that's the challenge to me. From what Joe was talking about, is where you are, you know, this is my position. God has placed me here for a purpose. And since he's placed me for a purpose, I'm supposed to do what God tells me to do, not necessarily what everyone else is doing. Thank you very much.
I think the key here is believing and living. I think we all believe in Christ. The problem comes when it's living for Christ, especially when you have to take a stand. And that's usually an issue, especially in the media industry, where you're under scrutiny and all that. So I guess the challenge to us and to me as an individual is your work showing? Because if it's not showing, then really, what are we doing? We have a higher calling. Do we know that we have that higher calling? Because there is this place in, I think it's in Hebrew, it says you have not been tempted to the point of shedding blood. I'm paraphrasing here. So until you get to that point, do we know that Christ is in us? Do we know that he's the strength that we have? Do we know that we have to stand? Because I think a lot of it is based on fear. A lot of it is based on this personality that we think we have. Or we are this reporter, so we need to look this certain way and we need to behave this certain way. So it has to come to a point where we can stand up and stand out, not disrespectfully, but knowing that we are in Christ and we are Christ. I guess that would be the challenge to us all, to believe in the higher calling that we have been given. Thank you.
I really didn't think there'd be something in between. So when he spoke about evangelizing, then it really made sense to me, because how do I evangelize if I'm not ethical? How do I evangelize if I'm not excellent? How do I evangelize if I'm not engaging? You know, sometimes we're always wondering, as an editor, how do I evangelize, as a reporter, as a news anchor, you know, because that's what your work is. But from what he spoke, I really believe that it's not really about what we do, it's about how we do it. And so, like, even at the top of my head, when I was thinking about how do I go forth, say I'm talking about property. It's not like I'll be going to evangelize the property, you know. I have a production team around me. There are many people I'll be interviewing, you know, and those are the people that then I will be able to evangelize to. And then one more thing that I picked out is working. And there's a verse that talks about work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Why are we told to work out? It's not something you just sit and you're like, yeah, we are saved, so everything is fine. You have to work it out. And so that's a challenge to me, and I guess it's a challenge to all of us.
I wish we all had the opportunity to say what we have mined, each one of us. But let's have Maura.
Thank you. I feel like the weight is heavy on me as the last one. For those who may have come in a bit later, Mr. Peter Deck, who started us off, talked about using media for transformation, narrowed in on three levels: changing structures, behavior, and then the hearts and minds of people. And he gave a quote that I don't think I'll ever forget: "Kenyans thought a new katiba would change the country. All we got was a new document." The country technically still hasn't changed. And as he was talking, I don't know if I'm responding to him or voicing my thoughts. I thought about the Christian journalist in a sense as a schizophrenic. Understand what a schizophrenic is? Society has defined it one way. I think of it as a person who has many things in their mind, pulling them in different directions, and sometimes not sure what to do. I'll give you an example. Yesterday, I went for a late lunch, which is common for anyone who works in the media, and I bumped into two of my colleagues who work in politics. I will not name them because some of our bosses are here. And they were talking about what it takes to get an exclusive story in politics. And I found them discussing how they used to do in the previous media house before they joined our media house. Now, apparently where they used to work, which I will also not name because I know there are those here who work there, there was an allowance for a drink up on Wednesday. Or is it me who's done this? There was an allowance for a drink up, I think, on Wednesday at a certain restaurant in Hurlingham. And how it works is that once your story is done, your editor grabs you by the hand and tells you, I need you and this other person to go to this hotel because so and so are going to be there. I want you to drink with them, but you need to stay sober enough so that when they start divulging the intrigues of politics, you are mentally noting. And so they decided to, so this person now comes to our media house, and one day on their own volition, they decide, let me show these people how to get a good political story. And so this person grabbed their colleague for company and said, let's go to this hotel, tutakuja na story. And they spent 3-4 hours, and of course you have to indulge, but you do it in a way that you do it carefully because you're actually there on a mission. Mm-hmm. And they told me that the next day, in the famous meeting that Joe Ageo referred to, when they were asked, what stories are we discussing today? Story 1, 2, and 3 were immediately proposed and accepted as exclusive stories. So can you imagine me as a political reporter? On one hand, Hesabika is asking me to stand up and be counted, translating concern into action. On the other hand, at the office, I am being asked, are those exclusive stories that you used to give us? We hired you, we poached you from the gutters of those other stations to come here and give us those stories. Where are they? I recently went online to read about how Christians in the West are practicing their media because I was going to speak somewhere about it. And I chanced upon an interesting article that talked about how a real Christian should behave when it comes to carrying out their job. And they talked about how a Christian should carry out an interview. And they said that you need to provide all the information before you go and do this interview. You need to brief the person. If they're uncomfortable, you should stop. You should carry out everything in light. Then I think about all the exclusive stories that have revealed things in society that have remained hidden for a long time. The other day, a forum of investigative journalists overseas leaked information about, what are they called, money transfers and people hiding money overseas. Were there Christians in that group? Is what they did ethical or unethical? Has it led to prosecution of people who are guilty of hiding money that should be used by citizens? At what point does Wahiga Mohora as a Christian, A, join such a group, leak information about all those who stolen money in Kenya, whistleblow, and do the story, vis-a-vis go to a person who you know has stolen and ask them for permission to ask them questions. Can I please interview you about the money that you stole 10 years ago in the Moi government? That is why I stand here today and say, I am further enlightened, but I am also slightly perplexed about how I am expected to carry out my job, because I feel like I'm a schizophrenic. On one hand, those who have gone before me are telling me that this is the way to go. But on the other hand, the media that we operate in, which is even more complicated than it has ever been before, is telling me that Wahiga, for you to be great, this is the only way. Where do I stand? And how do I stand to be counted in such an environment? Do I say that I am comfortable with not, quote unquote, achieving much, but maintaining my morals and standards? And is that excellence? Or do I say that I will go for it with everything that I have, but know that I might not take the brown envelopes, I'm not even here to justify that, but have I broken an ethical rule? Because I interviewed someone without their permission, I recorded them, I got a document from their office without their permission, but a story that then went on to make an impact. Where do I stand with that? I will leave it at that for now.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon, sorry. My name is Ruth Naya, and I'm born again. I love the Lord so much. I'm a journalist by going to school, but then again, I'm not practicing right now, but I'm trusting God I will be back. I think I have loved the presentations by the panelists. You have done an amazing job. I had questions to each and every one of you, but I think I'll just build up on what Maura was saying about the aspect of paying the price, you know, whereby you are in a place where there's controversy around you, and as a matter of fact, God expects you to shine the light, and He expects that from you. And at the other end, you're thinking, my job is dependent on whether I decide to pick up this story and run with it or not. Like right now, I'm on the forefront fighting against CSE, and I believe some, if not all, are aware about comprehensive sexuality education. And when I heard about this fellowship, I really wanted to be here. And particularly because I have some friends who are working in some of the media houses. And so I called up one of my friends and I told him, so you know about CSE. I have been giving you information about CSE. So what do you think we can do, because you are in the media? How can you help me? And so he paused and then he said, I'll call you back. So I waited, and I called back again. And I told him, hey, nimengoja. And he was like, you know, whatever you have asked me is a very tough question, because I have been trying to pull this conversation with my colleagues and all that, and everyone is hesitant about it. It's not that we are not aware, we are, but we know about the big business, yeah, whereby if you talk about this story, chances are there are people who are going to withdraw from bringing their advertisements in our organizations. And so that means that media house might collapse, in essence. And so he was saying, I don't even know what I'm supposed to do. I'm not sure if I'm supposed to even talk to you about this. I can't even talk about it on phone, so we'll meet up and have this conversation. And so when I heard him speaking on phone, I could genuinely feel the frustration, because he's a Christian. He knows what he's supposed to do. But at the other end, he feels that his hands are tied. So I'm thinking, as Christians and as journalists, so to say, are we willing to pay that? Because CSE, it will destroy if it is not destroying our children. And I want to ask also, as journalists, what are we going to do about CSE? Because like right now, so many people are ignorant. What are we going to do about this? Not only CSE, but the social justice matters concerning our society. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much. Go back to this plenary here. And I'll start by where we ended, with Joe. Then we just come to one route. If you had to say one last thing to this team,
yes,
first, what did you say?
And I think I'll say something about what Maura was talking about, because I think it would be a disservice if I didn't. There is a whole debate going on around there, as there are on many other things, about some of those dilemmas that Christians in secular, quote-unquote, cosma, media houses go through. And this is something that I think, how I look at it, is that first and foremost, as Christians in the media, we are truth tellers. That is a very important aspect of our job. Mm. All right? That we believe, our worldview, contrary to what many other people believe, is that there is the truth is there somewhere, some verifiable truth, that whereas we are fallen in our thinking and therefore we might not always get to this truth, but we will be found striving to get to that truth. And whereas there are places where you might say, oh yeah, you know, if your brother sins or whatever, go to them quietly and do that. But there are instances in the Bible where if someone was in error, they were rebuked publicly. When Paul rebuked Peter about eating so-called unclean meat or whatever, it was public. When Jesus found some people selling chicken and whatnot in the temple, it was a public spectacle. Why? Because he wanted other people to learn from the error of these people. And by the way, the only reason we know about all these ugly things that happened in the Bible is because someone reported it, and it is there for all of us to see. Otherwise, how would we know that Ananias and the wife conspired somewhere, perhaps in the bedroom? Why? Because they wanted to. The reason that account is there is so that we can know what happened and learn from it. So it rebukes even some of us who were not there when this happened. So I think we need to take a more nuanced understanding of what our roles are, because at the end of the day, we are on the side of the truth. That is what the scripture that, I don't know who quoted it here, the reason why Jesus came to testify to the truth. But the scripture doesn't end there.
Well, one thing I just like to mention, feeling schizophrenic is part of what will always be your feeling as a Christian professional. It's got nothing to do with the media. It's got everything to do with being a Christian in a fallen world. We live as Christians between what is called the now and the not yet. We live in a state where, you know, we know that certain things God has done and has given us now, but it is not yet the perfection that God seeks. So you're going to live in a state of, yes, but I wish, and unfortunately that I wish will never be satisfied until the other side of heaven. There's somebody who was a mentor of mine in some of these issues of marketplace, and he said, learn, I'll give you even the reference you can read it. He wrote an essay, and his essay is titled this, Learning to Make Peace with Proximate Justice. Proximate means approximate and not perfect justice. If your beat is the legal system and you're dealing with some dimension social justice issues, if that's your beat, it's messy. One of the things when people come and say, it's like, I'm telling you, engaging in the market is why? Because the market, what did Christ say? The thorns and the tares must grow together. He didn't say, by the way, if you see it, just get out of that shop and go somewhere else. You try and plant a farm and make sure there's no weeds. It ain't gonna happen. And that's how the marketplace is. So let's not try and say, I'm not trying to contaminate. You know, the guys, those were called Pharisees or monks, and they used to go out there. But Christ did something complicated. He did something on the Sabbath. He said, if picking a donkey that has fallen, then you know that the Pharisees would even wait for you, even the ounces of food and even the kilometers or miles you need to walk. And Christ is lifting the donkey. But let me just talk about this whole question of a mind here. This is what I was talking about, worldview. This is what I was saying about the narrative. I think your job as a journalist is to have the mind of Christ dwell in you richly. It's not just about going and reporting these things as fact. Every view point, every point of view, sorry, every point of view has a viewpoint. It's this, that let's just talk about growth. We're all for growth, fighting poverty. At what point does growth become greed, and growth become even hedonism? You know what hedonism is? Really using things for some stories I see on
okay, there's the lady who does the property and whatever. But some of these things, it's pure hedonism. You know, at what point does, no, I'm not saying a story, I'm just saying, you know, please, I, you know, in Kenya, just say, you know, is there anything distasteful? Is there, it's okay to be rich, and God bless us, God will teach us to prosper. Is there something, the difference between being rich and being filthy rich? Mm. So, are you just going to go there and say, these people living in the luxury, they've got the jacuzzi, they've got the whatever? What is the Christian underlying worldview? Mm. So ask yourself that other question. You know, at least am I promoting hedonism and a lifestyle that is going contrary? So let's live in nice houses, but please let's not promote hedonism. So if your beach is that, I mean, you know, so what is the underlying worldview? If your beach is, let's say, prisons, you know, and it just goes so many people in committee, so many, you know, but hang on a minute. Could there be an underlying problem with our prison system? That we've got a retributive system of justice, which is about punishment, rather than in the Bible, what you see is a restorative system. Mm.
What do I even say after that? I'll just summarize mine in, I think, three lines. Borrowing from the Focus, you know, initiative, let's stand up and be counted. Secondly, let's be consistent in who we are. At the workplace, at the home, with our friends, be consistent. That is the strength of character. And finally, be resilient in this fight, that good fight that Joe has been talking about. It takes a lot of effort, conscious decision making, and sacrifice. God bless.
I'm just so grateful that we've had this forum, and I think this forum could have been a group of doctors, it could have been a group of, you know, surveyors, because really, as Joe and others have said here, it really comes back to you. It comes back to your relationship with God, because we all want to see a better world out there, we want to see transformation, we want to see a better Kenya. And it's so much easier to talk about, can we change this or do that? But I'll just leave you with this. This is something that has challenged me even as I've listened to you. I've been reminded of something my wife used to ask me rather randomly. It was a question that sometimes would throw me off. And you know, have you ever seen like a rabbit in the night, your headlights on the right here? You know, you sort of. she asked me in a very odd place, maybe in a supermarket line, you know, Pete, what is God saying to you? You know? and the point of this question was sometimes, I want to know, saying about what? He says, no, is God speaking to you? And if God is not speaking to you, why? Is it that you're not listening, or God has stopped speaking to you? And I want to leave us with this point that, and I'm speaking again to myself, in these situations we can come up with prescriptive things about how to respond to this situation, how to respond to that situation. But what I'm also hearing, and I'm endorsing very strongly, ask yourself that question. Because being a Christian in the marketplace, Jesus actually said they will hate you. Things are going to go against you because of me. And in each of these situations, it's not about pursuing to be hated, but pursuing to live the will of God.
And I know that as we move out of here, we will be credible, trustworthy sources who are clear about how we want to go about our jobs for impact. Tutahesabika. And who better to close this for us than Dr. Washira? You know, Dr. Timothy Washira is a vet doctor, but he has since moved to Chaperon, the university. So where are all the graduates of Daystar? Where do they go to? I'm one of them, some here. And so I'm not asking him to tell us where they are. I think we are here. We are in different places. And I would like to welcome Dr. Washira. He's the Vice Chancellor of Daystar University. We're very privileged to have him here. I think most of you, including myself, have gone through Daystar, and we know that the reason you have that perspective is because somebody sat you in class and said, go out there and don't just become a journalist. In my days, we're given a towel, and it was called the Order of the Towel. Mm-hmm. I don't know that it still happens, but we're given a towel, a white towel, to go and serve. Oh, it no longer happens.
No, sorry. I haven't graduated yet. Anyway,
so Dr. Washira is going to come and help us wrap up and also lead us into a commitment. Because faith without works is
yes.
Thank you. Welcome.
The critical issues that were being said is you, it all depends on you. It is not where you are, it is not what it is that you're doing, it is your relationship with God and your submission to Him. But the critical thing is that you have a mission. The unfortunate thing, worldview has been mentioned here. The worldview that is created in our minds and in our lives, in our homes, since we went to school, since we were born, is that you live, you are created, and you live to get good job and to be rich. And you go to school so that you satisfy yourself. Now, with that, in journalism, what we are discussing becomes useless. Because if that is what you have gone for, then anything goes, because as long as you go out, you get more money, you become more famous, you're living for yourself. If you're living for yourself, Hesabika, you will never be Hesabika. We have to live for have a higher purpose. You have to have a mission. And I think all what we have been told, you have a mission. And if the mission, then you have to be accountable. So the main issue we are coming to, do we have a mission? Do we have something higher than ourselves and our calling that we have to live for? We need to clarify in our minds, do I have a calling? And once we have to, we get to that, the next question that comes, and I think all of them have said it, am I willing to pay for it? And Christ says, the paying for it may even come to paying with your life. What I like is that Christ doesn't mean words. He doesn't call it that payment. It may be little, it may be with her. She said 200,000, it may be with your whole house, with your job, but it may be even with your life. And Christ says, if you're not ready to pay it with your life, don't then leave my mission alone, just go on being a journalist and a normal journalist. If you're not willing to pay it with your job, with your own life, then leave it. That's the calling of Christ. And then the final is how you do it as a servant. So not with the power of a Christian or the power of a journalist or whichever the power, is doing it with the humility that Christ has, the mind of Christ. And I think I will not go beyond that. That is what we have been called. Now the conference that Bwana Maura mentioned, in it, it was at three days. Now we have had one for 3 hours. you can now imagine 3 hours and 3 days. It can't compare, isn't it? And yet we want to call you to commit yourself almost to the same level we asked the people for 3 days to commit themselves. So it's an unfair request. But recognize that you're not committing yourself to us, you're committing yourself to God. I don't think it's an unfair request. May I ask that a covenant be distributed to each one of us? Who are the people who have committed themselves? Just in case we want to call the Hesabika people together at any time. So we would want to know your information. There's nothing else beyond that, okay? Now, the rest, don't bother about anything else below that. Just tick, is there media engagement? Nothing else, okay? However, you may have something else, and you may tick that. But this one is only so that you may have a record, and you may have a record yourself. Yes. But we will start with this one. Again, I will release you. If you feel you are not ready, Joe Ageo, reminded us of a gentleman and his wife. The gentleman was called the one who died for coming to say things before. Shall we now read Hezabika Covenant together?
Yes.
Are you there, Hezabika Covenant?
Yes.
Let's read it. Having heard God speak to me at the Hezabika Convention, which is this one, and challenge me no longer be a spectator on the sidelines when the foundations of our nations are collapsing, and having prayerfully considered the call to be an agent of transformation for our nation, I covenant to practice and model the highest standards of personal and professional integrity in everything I do. I will not accept or give a bribe or be involved in any form of corruption as an individual or in my corporate responsibilities. Amen?
Amen.
I covenant to pursue excellence in my daily vocation and work as unto God, using my talents and opportunities to bring healing and restoration to a broken world. I will abhor selfish ambition and trust God to help me love Him with all my heart, mind and soul, and love my neighbor as I love myself. I covenant to actively engage in promoting peace, justice, and good governance for the common good. All Kenyans are my brothers and sisters, and I will not look down on any of them or discriminate on the basis of age, tribe, gender, race, or religion. I covenant to promote godly values in all my interactions at personal, family, community, and national levels. I will network with other like-minded people to foster positive change in economic, social, and spiritual well-being of our nation.
I want to believe that for those of you who are here, who are IMF members, who began to think, this is not something that affects only that news anchor who stands in front and reads the news. I believe that mass begins here and goes up.